it wasn't for goats, we wouldn't have coffee. Look it up.
I want to get some coffee. You want some coffee?
No, thank you. I'm fine.
And the best sports talk in Acadiana. 103.3 The Goat.
Great Scott!
The Great Scott Show.
And as they head into the final furlong, all of the other radio stations and radio hosts are left in the wake of a keen turn of speed by The Great Scott Show, the champion.
With Scott Prather.
Steal the show.
Hello, everybody, and welcome into the Great Scott Show. Good morning. I am happy to be back on the airwaves with you. It is February. Can't get here soon enough if you're the Pelicans. My goodness. Sean Payton is heading to Denver. We will break all of that down, all of that and more. Here we go. It's the Great Scott Show, 103.3 The Goat, simulcast on 1420. Looking forward to hanging out this morning. The Fabulous Cajun Chicken returning to the Cajun Dome this Saturday for UL's basketball game. Cajuns, who are also on an 8-game winning streak, by the way. Looking forward to that. We'll visit with him at 7:15. Gerry Glasco, Raging Cajun softball coach. Their season begins in 9 days. We'll talk to Coach Glasco. I got a lot of questions for him as we preview the season. It's National Signing Day, though I don't know how much we'll really detail each thing. I'll kind of keep you aware of any signings that come through. But let's start with Sean Payton. Sean Payton is now a Bronco. There are conflicting reports as to how close he was or was not to being the Broncos coach. Ian Rappaport says, oh no, he was going to be, you know, he was always in the mix, but never the number one guy. They wanted D'Amico Ryans, then they wanted Jim Harbaugh, then he wanted Ryans, and they settled for Payton. Find it odd you'd settle for somebody and but give up everything you gave up to get him. More than that, Adam Schefter said, no, you know, that it was always the plan. Payton was their guy. At this point, you know what? Who cares? The deal is done. And Saints fans all had, I would say most Saints fans were not happy about it. And there's a couple ways to look at this. Okay. Look at it. Realistically, Sean Payton did not want to be the coach of the Saints. He quit on the Saints. He wanted to get back into coaching as soon as possible. He wanted a raise. He wanted control. He wanted to go somewhere different. And at the end of the day, he got what he wanted. I heard Saints fans for, you know, the last year. Well, yeah, but get a first-round pick. They got a first-round pick. Oh, yeah, but it's late. Okay, it's a first-round pick, 29th overall. And they also got a second-round pick. In 2024, excuse me. I'm going to turn off the mic to cough a little bit. Listen. The one thing that was a little annoying was that it was kind of a pick swap. Throwing in that third-round pick along with Payton. The 2024 third-round pick. That's just a little annoying. There aren't a lot of situations like this. You know, a lot of folks just compare it to the John Gruden deal from Oakland to Tampa Bay. Well, that was over 20 years ago. And yes, it was a major haul. Two first-round picks, two second-round picks. But the situation was different. Payton was working for Fox. Gruden was still coaching the Raiders. Mike Holmgren had an escape clause in his contract in Green Bay. So the stipulation was already within the contract if he left what Green Bay would get. Bruce Arians, he landed with the Bucs, but he had stepped down from his previous job a season before with the Cardinals. That's the most recent one. Arians, who, by the way, went on to win a Super Bowl in Tampa. You know what they get? You know what they got from Tampa Bay? A pick swap. They traded him in a seventh-round pick to Tampa Bay in exchange for a sixth-round pick. I would say the Saints did a little better than that. It's not a John Gruden-level deal. But Payton was the best candidate on the market. Who knows what might happen next year? Oh, the Saints had the rights. They should have waited. Okay, what happens next year? They got two picks in the top 64. It really comes down to, can they hit on the 29th overall pick? Why? Because when you have a late first-round pick that performs, you get them at great value for 5 years. If it's outside of the first round, you only have it for four. Ryan Ramczyk has been one of the most impactful Saints, not just because of how he plays on the field, but because you had him on a rookie deal as the second-to-last pick in the draft for 5 years, and he was an AP All-Pro. Now, if you strike out there and you get a Davenport type or a Peyton Turner type, yeah, not too good. Will the Saints even keep it? Are they going to trade it? Are they going to package it? Are they going to use it to get a... who knows? But in 2024, they may have two picks in the first 50. They should have two picks in the first 50. They're first, and then Denver second. Of course, who knows? Payton might have success. Payton might go there and fix the problems in Denver. I'll tell you this, and I'll have Brandon Stokely on the show soon. I know this. They're happy in Denver right now. And we don't know yet exactly what Payton is going to be making. Coaches' contracts typically are not public. There are various websites that calculate how much about approximately what they make. Approximately around ballpark, Payton was making like $9.8 million his last year in New Orleans, according to a couple of reports. Reports also suggested he wanted between $20 to $25 million a year wherever he went next. I don't know what he's making, but I promise you this. It's a lot, and it's more than he was making in New Orleans. Denver gave up a lot to get a guy that they figured, hey, look, a Payton saved us before. Let's try a Payton again. We're married to Russell Wilson here. Whether we want to be or not, based on this contract, we need to get it fixed. Let's get a guy that has worked with a short quarterback that might not have the strongest arm but seems to be cerebral. Now, Drew Brees never had a season like Russell Wilson had last year in Denver, ever. That thing was weird. And I think for the Saints, it's nice to not have the Peyton thing hanging over their head for another season. Now the Saints can begin moving forward with the process of what they want to do next, which they need to get under the salary cap and create $30 million or $35 million in money to spend. Excuse me. And they can do that by converting lots of signing bonuses and releasing a couple of players. Sean Payton is finally somewhere else. And it was a team that appeared to be interested in him first and where he ended up last. And D'Amico Ryans heads to Houston, where the last 2 years they fired a head coach after one season. Hired black head coach the last two seasons, fired him after 1 year, D'Amico Ryans. Well, he used to play in Houston. Oddly enough, D'Amico Ryans at one point in time sued the Texans. Like 8 years ago when he was playing blaming their playing surface on his injury, and then the suit ended up getting, I don't know, how do I put it, altered away from the Texans onto the company that put the field down. Might have been good for D'Amico. I don't know that the Texans would have hired him had he ended up following through and suing them. But a six-year deal, it doesn't feel like they're hiring D'Amico Ryans to be a one-and-done coach like they did with David Culley and Lovie Smith. But who knows? We'll see. 11 after the hour. We're going to talk more about that. Keep tabs on National Signing Day a little bit. The state of the Pelicans, ooh, man. Let's just hope February is better than January because, oh, my God, was it bad for the Pels. From first to, what, 10th? Oof. Oof. We'll get into that. We'll get into that. We'll talk Cajun hoops a little bit. Cajun softball at 8 o'clock. Gerry Glasco joins me. But the fabulous Cajun chicken. For those of you that are older, that remember, that know, you know what's happening. This guy made his debut at Blackman Coliseum nearly 40 years ago. Had some great just skits. I mean, you know, he was awesome. Classic skits. And for the most part has been gone for the last 20 years. Made a return in 08 for a game. But he'll be back this Saturday. One night only. We'll talk to Russell Heim. That's his name in real life. The fabulous Cajun chicken. Next, right here on the Great Scott Show. 103.3 The GOAT. Simulcast on 1420. It's the GOAT. Greatest sports talk of all time. I'm Scott Prather. Be careful out there. It's cold. Cloudy, cool, 40% chance of rain, high of 50. Be safe out on the road. Happy Wednesday, everybody. Welcome to February. We're back after this.
Thirsty for intelligent sports talk? Sounds like you need a little Gatorade. 103.3 The GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all time.
Scott Show, 103.3 The GOAT, simulcast on 1420. Well, sports news just broke. Tom Brady announces he's retiring. Again, we'll see if he decides to come out of retirement. Like our next guest, for one night only, maybe certainly this Saturday, Russell Heim, the fabulous Cajun chicken, will return to the Cajun home this Saturday night for UL's game at the Dome, and it'll be a lot of fun. Russell, good morning. Yes. Welcome into the
good
show.
Morning.
How are you feeling?
I'm very excited about it. I'm nervous about it, simply because I hadn't appeared in a long time. But I am so ready to put my feathers back on and be on the court with the great Cajun fans and be a part of it once again.
I mean, should I call you Russell or just Fabulous Cajun Chicken, FCC? What's the proper nomenclature here during the interview?
Yeah, since we're interviewing the chicken, we can just say chicken. How's that?
Chicken. All right, chicken. I'll go with chicken. Sure, chicken works. Chicken. Man, I, you know, like many, I remember your performances from when I was younger, and I would see Cajun players get distracted and kind of start watching you during a timeout, but it was when the other team would get distracted or want to start messing with you. There was a game against UALR, and I mean, every timeout, this player on their team, he just, you know, he kept looking behind his back, like, waiting to do something or waiting for you. It was a different time. I mean, sports kind of evolves. Do you feel like that would be as acceptable today? Like the whole idea, because it was all in fun. You know what I mean? I mean, it's not your fault if the other team, but you know, people are more sensitive now. Like, oh, he shouldn't mess with the ref or he shouldn't mess with the other team. Do you feel like the Fabulous Cajun Chicken would work as well today? It's going to work Saturday. It's going to be awesome. But work sort of all the time like it did back in the day? Or do you think sports has kind of changed that a little bit?
A lot of the skits and stuff that I did, I don't think would be acceptable today with the culture the way it is. Not that they were bad or obnoxious. It's just the culture would look at it and somebody would go, I didn't like that. I am offended by it, probably. But for most of the skits that I'll be doing are the ones that definitely didn't offend anybody.
What is your favorite all-time skit?
Oh, I've said this before. I hate this question. Because there's so many that I enjoy doing. And it's been totally depending on the situation. The Michael Jackson, everybody loves. The Grim Reaper, everybody loves. Love some of the interactions. We don't have it anymore. Simply Dave Verisco, who's been my partner in all of this for so many years, we used to do skits where he had tearaway pants, and we'd be messing with each other on the court or the field. Those were always a lot of fun because they catch a lot of people off guard.
Yeah, that element of surprise. Your little, I guess, spider prank where you have it on the hook.
Yes.
That thing. I mean, I remember when you came back, I think it was in 08, for a game against Western Kentucky, and just watching just fan after fan fall for that thing and flip out. I don't know what it is about, you know, seeing somebody scream because they're startled just for a second. It'll never not be funny to me. And then you add in, you've got a giant crowd and everybody's watching. It somehow makes it just, it just elevates it, you know.
Well, we did that spider. I was doing a baseball game in Lynchburg, Virginia, and I dropped the spider down in front of a lady. Well, she had a full beer, and she threw the beer at the spider. She hit the spider and beer went everywhere. And when the spider swung over in front of another lady who had a beer, she threw it. It was just a massive splash. All of a sudden, it's like, I'm in trouble. I better get out of this section.
Chicken joins us now, Rasan, the Fabulous Cajun Chicken. Was there a skit you ever did that was, like, dangerous, that, like, you look back on and you're like, man, what was I thinking?
No, I tried to keep myself safe on everything that I was doing and keep it under control. There were skits that didn't work, and we got rid of them very quickly. And there were skits that I did that people were supposed to be a part of, and they're just sitting in the dugout laughing at me when they didn't come out. So it was those types of deals where you should sit there and go, well, the rest of this game better be good.
Senior night, kids night, Our Lady of Lords night, Acadian alumni night. That's this Saturday against Marshall. The Fabulous Cajun Chicken will be there. And, you know, Louisiana and Marshall, take a look at the standings. This is a huge game. So you're going to want to be at the Cajun Dome Saturday. You're going to want to be at the Cajun Dome Saturday.
This will be a great game.
All right.
Anybody who wasn't at the Dome last Saturday night and witnessed that comeback, that was Cajun basketball at its best.
Whenever you're at the games,
the team is playing right now,
yeah,
everybody needs to be out there. And they have special ticket prices for this weekend, I heard. So, yeah, come on out, man. And when I heard it was senior night, I figured, well, I'm a senior citizen. They must be honoring me, but it was the wrong senior.
How did you, at what point did you decide, I want to come back for a game? What kind of shape do you need to get into? And what was the process like of setting this up? Do you just make one phone call and they're like, yep? Or, how did this thing come together?
I was at a basketball game near the beginning of the season and ran across Gerald Aber. And he said, well, we'd love to have you back. Would you come back? And I said, well, Gerald, I don't know. I just kind of put it on hold. Then I received a phone call from the athletic department saying, hey, can you come in and talk to us? So we talked about it. The biggest thing I told him, I said, look, I don't even know if I have a workable costume. I don't know what props I still have. They're in a box in storage somewhere. So I went through, found everything, and from that point on, it's like, let's pick a date. This is a date they asked me to do, and it's like, I can be there. So I've been trying to do a little bit of road work and get myself in semi-shape for this. I'm glad it's not a football game because that's where I did most of my running.
So how old are you in chicken years?
Man, I'd probably be about 1,000 in chicken years.
All right.
But I'm 65 in human years.
There you go. What is like, I mentioned how this all came together for Saturday. What are the origins of the Fabulous Cajun Chicken? Like, is it, where did you get the costume? At what point did you know, like, I want to do mascot stuff, I want to do skits? How did it all come together where you, most folks around here obviously know you from UL, and I think you made your mm-hmm. debut at Blackham Coliseum almost 40 years ago, but how did it all come together for you, with, I guess, the persona of the chicken and something that, obviously was endearing and left an impact on a lot of people because they still talk about it today?
Yeah. The chicken came about, I was actually doing Budman. And if you remember, Budman had come in for the Budweiser Classic, basketball classic, and that was back in 1982. And I did the rest of the basketball games that year. Well, I did a game on ESPN. They referred to me as a USL's mascot, being the Budman. At that time, they said no more Budman because the university is trying to get rid of our party image. That's when they brought out Mr. Cajun the next year. It didn't go. I got a call on a Wednesday from Wright Waters, who was the associate athletic director at the time. He said, Russell, we'd like you to come back and do another character. Can you have something there for Saturday's game? I went scrambling around looking at stores. I found two costumes. One was a dog, one was a bird. I took the bird costume. Later on, after a few appearances, it got dubbed the Cajun Chicken by Bruce Brown over the sports writer at the Advertiser. And that's how the name came about. Then I started having my costumes made locally. Miss Millie Francois, who's no longer with us, made all my costumes. And the skits, they just kind of developed. One day I was playing with something. It's like, I could do something with this. And then after that, it was watching a lot of Roadrunner cartoons, looking at how the coyote went so over the top on some of the stuff. And that's how I tried to develop the skits along that genre of, hey, we're going to go way over the top, be so crazy or stupid or whatever, funny, but we have to do it within a 30 to 45 second to get the whole idea across. And that's how we went about developing David and I.
What is the number one thing every mascot must have to be successful?
A unique personality, I guess. You've got to be able to be very animated to get out there. You can't just stand there. You've got to be, I've coached a lot of younger high school kids. You've got to be animated and to make sure that whatever you're doing down there, the people in the top row can see it. And that's just being over the top and having lots of energy and be able to put up with the heat and the costume.
Gotcha. Good stuff. The Fabulous Cajun Chicken has been our guest, Russell Heim. He will be performing this Saturday, Louisiana versus Marshall. Huge game. It'll also be senior night, kids night, Our Lady of Lourdes night, Acadian alumni night. Cajuns have a big week. They're playing Texas State tomorrow and then Marshall on Saturday. Yep. Fabulous Cajun Chicken will be there. It's going to be a great night. Should be electric crowd. And any new sketches you're going to be pulling out? I mean, you got to go with classics, right? It's like when an old entertainer comes back, they got to play the hits. But I'm sure you got a few things up your, I don't know what a chicken would call a sleeve, but whatever that is.
Yeah, up my beak.
There you go.
I don't know. There are a couple of things. If I can put this stuff together quick enough, I'm actually working on a project here in Houston. So I'm not at home putting this stuff together right now. So I'm trying to work out of my hotel room. But I've got a couple ideas of things that if I get a chance, I'm going to try.
Awesome. One more for you. Where did you, how did the Fabulous Cajun Chicken, was it work stuff, life stuff? Why did it, I get asked this a lot. I'm sure you've been asked. I don't know. I mean, I've never met you personally outside of your costume, but why did the chicken go away?
Back, that was 1999. They called me in and we talked a little bit about the chicken's popularity. It actually got too popular to where people were asking to see more skits. This is a university. It's about the students. And as we discussed it, people at that time were saying, no, we don't want to hear the band. We don't want to see the jazz. We don't want to see the cheerleaders. We want to see what the chicken's going to do. This is about the university. This is about the students. This is a student function. And I was just a hired help. And they were switching over to the new marketing campaign with the pepper. So it was like we all sat down and agreed, okay, maybe it's time that I step away from the university with this. Because it is. It's about the students. And that's where it needed to be.
Well, I know you're excited to be back Saturday. I know a lot of folks are excited to see you.
I'm so excited about it.
It must be a trip for you, kind of. I mean, I'm sure you get nostalgic from time to time, right?
Oh, definitely. When I'm... That game last Saturday night with all those timeouts, boy, did I want to be down on that court.
Looking forward to seeing it, Chicken, on Saturday night, man. Yeah. I appreciate you taking the time this morning. All the best.
Thank you for inviting me. And I once again tell everybody, let's just pack the dome. We need to really let these seniors know how much we appreciate all their hard work. This is a great team this year. If you haven't been following them, you'd need to be. This is a very special team this year.
Good stuff. Appreciate it, Russell. Excuse me, Mr. Chicken. We'll talk to you later. All the best.
Thank you, sir. Y'all have a great day.
There you go. The Fabulous Cajun Chicken. Learned a little bit there. Learned a little bit. Tom Brady. Fabulous Cajun Chicken retired because he got too popular. But he comes back for little special appearances. Although the last time he came back, it was like 15 years ago. It's been a minute. Tom Brady, is he retiring from the NFL for good? Here's what he had to say on his social media platforms this morning.
Good morning, guys. I'll get to the point right away. I'm retiring. For good. I know the process was a pretty big deal last time, so when I woke up this morning, I figured I just press record and let you guys know first. So I won't be long-winded. Like, you only get one super emotional retirement essay, and I used mine up last year. So I really thank you guys so much to every single one of you for supporting me, my family, my friends, my teammates, my competitors. I could go on forever. There's too many. Thank you guys for allowing me to live my absolute dream. I wouldn't change a thing. Love you all.
So I'd recommend checking out the video, which you can see over at the 1033 The Goat app, 1033thegoat.com as well. You know, he gets a little emotional there. It's hard to tell because he's had a little bit of plastic surgery. His face doesn't move the way it used to, but he, you know, he's at a beach somewhere and wrote, "Truly grateful on this day. Thank you." Just gets right to the point. Says he's retiring for good. He announced his retirement last year on February 1st, 2022. 1 year ago today, he announced his retirement. If only he had waited one more day last year and one more day this year, we would have endless Groundhog's Day jokes. And once you do it once and come back, there are going to be a whole lot of folks that don't believe him. You know what? I believe him. I guess. Is he done? Yeah. He says it's for good. He says it's for good. But obviously the decision was grinding on him. Right? He was, you know, going off on Jim Gray last week for just simply asking him. But Tom today says, you know what, guys? I'm done.
Good morning, guys. I'll get to the point right away. I'm retiring for good. I know the process was a pretty big deal last time, so when I woke up this morning, I figured I just press record and let you guys know first. So I won't be long-winded. I think you only get one super emotional retirement essay, and I used mine up last year. So really thank you guys so much to every single one of you for supporting me, my family, my friends, my teammates, my competitors. I could go on forever. There's too many. Thank you guys for allowing me to live my absolute dream. I wouldn't change a thing. Love you all.
There it is. If he actually is retired, he will step into Fox's lead role as analyst next year. Now you've got what, Burkholder and Greg Olson, who will call the Super Bowl. But who is Brady going to, who's going to be the guy that they put him with? Who is going to be the A team? And how quickly will Fox even try to start assessing that move? Probably want to give it a little time. As I said, February 1st, 2022, Tom Brady announced his retirement. Man. You guys believe him? Hit me up. 337-269-1077. 337-269-1077. You can tweet the show as well, at 1033TheGOAT. You can email me, Scott at 1033TheGOAT.com. Chico says, until he's not on the field in week one, I won't believe it. Let me tell you something, and I don't blame you, Chico. He could not be on the field by week eight, and they will still be talking about him. When Brett Favre retired after his, you know, second year with the Vikings when he played awful, he didn't retire after the Saints put that beating on him in the NFC title game. He should have. He didn't. He came back for another year, and it was not a good year. He was 41, but he looked more like he was in his mid-50s. I mean, he was beat up. Brady has not taken the hits that Favre is, at least not on the football field. He's probably taken a few from a few plastic surgeons. But he will get rumored to be coming back for a while. I don't even know when the end date is. It might have to be a whole year or two. Because he could drag this thing out, say, I'm retired, guys. Next season will start, and when a good team loses their quarterback, there will be talks of, hey, you think about coming out of the booth? Thinking about going down on the field? Thinking about coming back? There'll be rumors of, I've heard through sources that they have, some team reached out to Tom Brady's representatives, which Brady just might just be like, no, I don't even care. Don't even bother me with it. And yet just the idea that representatives of his were contacted by some team just to see if he had any interest, that will drag out the news cycle. So even though he says he's retired for good, get ready and prepare yourself for an entire calendar year of Brady may return. Had he retired last year, had he stayed retired, he would have, his final game would have been a narrow loss to the Rams where he brought them all the way back, gave them a late lead only for the defense to lose it late. And oh my God, the year before he brought the Bucs to the Super Bowl. And oh, it's Brady. But he came back. Tampa Bay got outscored more than any other team in a putrid division. They won it with a losing record, and then they got bounced by the Cowboys, a team that doesn't have the greatest history, at least in the 21st century, of winning playoff games. 21st century. Got handled by Dallas. So why wouldn't they? Dallas was good. Tampa Bay wasn't. No, it's not going to be the main thing you remember it about Tom Brady. Of course it's not, assuming he stays retired. But Brady, like most all-time greats, does not go out on top. Peyton Manning wasn't playing great at the end of his career, not because of, you know, he wasn't of sound mind, but because his body was not in the shape of a quarterback, and yet he was still able to finesse into a Super Bowl victory and retire. Also in Denver, John Elway, back-to-back, retires as a player. It is rare that all-time greats get to do that. Jordan could have done it, but he came back, played 2 years with the Wizards, couldn't even get in the playoffs. It's just not how it works. The majority of the time, your all-time greats are on their field of play, lose a game, and just realize, you know what? This is it. It doesn't end well on the field. It doesn't. I mean, you know, how many of you think of Emmitt Smith in a Cardinals uniform? You don't. How many of you think of Joe Namath in a Rams uniform? You don't. Heck, many years from now, I mean, maybe not for Saints fans, but I think for most folks, it'll be weird just to picture Brady in a Bucs uniform. You're going to picture him in a Patriots uniform. Whenever somebody has a Jordan debate, which, God, with LeBron coming up on the scoring record, the MJ LeBron debate, which has just been insufferable over the years, but when you're picturing Jordan in your head, you're not picturing him in a Wizards jersey, you're picturing him in a Bulls jersey. That's what you remember. You don't really, the first thing that comes to your mind isn't the end, but the end for the vast majority of your greats in their sport, it's in defeat, and oftentimes, not just defeat, but like overwhelming defeat. Just don't have it anymore. Heck, had Favre retired after the Saints beat the Vikings in the NFC Championship game? Why do you ponder passing? Yeah, we'd make jokes. Certainly we, down here in South Louisiana, would remember Porter's pick and Favre's last play and yucking it up, all this stuff, giggle, giggle. But, like, he would have gone out and been like, man, he was right there in the Super Bowl. He was just going for it. He was good. Instead, he comes back the next year and it's just pabal. Don't let the fact that the Bucs won the division fool you from the fact that they were just a bad football team this year and Brady wasn't good. All this talk about him coming back, there are teams, according to Adam Schefter, that are interested in trying to bring him back for a year. He's going to be 46 in August. Unless there's a team in the NFL with the best offensive line that desperately needs a quarterback, I don't think he's coming back now. Team with a great offensive line loses a quarterback during the season. That might be a possibility. But if you want to see the video of this, head over to the 103.3 The GOAT app.
Good morning, guys. I'll get to the point right away. I'm retiring. for good. I know the process was a pretty big deal last time, so when I woke up this morning, I figured I'd just press record and let you guys know first, so I won't be long-winded. Like, you only get one super emotional retirement essay, and I used mine up last year, so really thank you guys so much to every single one of you for supporting me, my family, my friends, my teammates, my competitors. I could go on forever. There's too many. Thank you guys for allowing me to live my absolute dream. I wouldn't change a thing. Love you all.
There you go. 337-269-1077. Phone lines are open. Brady's retirement. Sean Payton, the trade there. Those are the big topics of conversation this morning. We will talk UL softball with head coach Gerry Glasco. That was an interview that's been scheduled for a while. Looking forward to talking to him coming up in about 15 minutes. Let's head to the phone lines. Good morning. Welcome into the Great Scott Show. Hello.
I believe him.
I think I do too, Kyle. I think I do too.
Let's put it like this. He should have retired last year. Okay, he waited a year too long.
Yeah,
and he tarnished his legacy. Which, if you're a guy like that now, you're only playing because of your legacy. Why are you going to destroy the thing that you're playing for?
Yeah, I think destroy maybe is hyperbole. I don't know if he destroyed it. I don't think it was, you know, in the long run. I don't think it's this giant scarlet. I wouldn't go that far. I wouldn't say that. No,
he tarnished it. Yeah,
You think Tom Brady has tarnished his entire legacy by this past season? Really?
Somewhat. Yeah, he tarnished it a little
somewhat,
bit.
I say somewhat. A little. Okay, now it's a little.
Year, yeah. If he plays this year, it's ruined. If he plays this year, he looks like a desperate old man trying to add to his record.
Is Emmitt Smith's entire career just tarnished because he played 2 years for the Cardinals?
And no. You said it yourself. Nobody even remembers it.
That's my point. Exactly.
Well, there you go. That's a part of your legacy. If he played for anybody, right? But especially if he played for the Bucks another year, nobody even remembered that he won a Super Bowl with the Bucks. They don't remember that he drove the Bucks.
No.
Totally
they would remember
the
he won the Super Bowl. If Emmitt Smith was good with the Cardinals, it would be remembered. My point is, when all is said and done, folks are going to remember Brady in a Patriots helmet than you know this last season, which was awful.
All I know is I'm glad for the good of the sport that he's decided to leave because what he did last year was not good for the sport. And the fact that the league had to help his team by giving him 500 free holding calls for his offensive line during the season, which was a fact. That's what they did. 500 blatant, absolutely pitiful, brutal holding calls. By the worst offensive line I've ever seen in the NFL. That was the worst offensive line ever in the history of the league. But they weren't the worst because they got away with anything. I mean, to get a holding call out of that, you had to have a 2-on-1 takedown where they ripped the jersey all over the guy's head to get a holding call in Tampa. That was unbelievable what the league let them get away with so that this guy didn't get killed. Okay. He should have been hospitalized by the third game of the season. The man was a shell of what he had ever been as a quarterback in his life. And it was miserable to have to watch that on an NFL football field. It was miserable. It reminded me of Joe Namath when Joe Namath was washed up, beat up, no good, pathetic, and he was out there. Not that Namath was ever really that great.
He wasn't.
But huh?
He wasn't. I'm saying he wasn't. He was never that great.
No, he wasn't that great. He was never that great. But he had that persona. But his last years at LA were absolutely miserable. You had a guy out there who shouldn't have been out there and a team that, you know, and it was just like it was horrible to watch. Okay, so I'm just saying, I'm glad Brady left. He should have left a year ago. How about the Saints? Sean Payton going to take the Broncos job. And what did the Saints get? About the same as they got for CeeDee Deuce. Nothing. Basically, you gave them a third for the second. What did you do, Mickey Loomis? Mickey Loomis is now owned by the Philadelphia general management. He's now owned by the Broncos general management. I wonder how many more people are going to own Mickey Loomis. This is over. Mickey Loomis is now proven without Sean Payton, he is a nothing. He's an empty chair. That's what he is, an empty chair. Mickey, you need to retire. You need to follow Tom Brady right out the door.
You're breaking up there.
Today.
You're breaking up there, Kyle. You're breaking up, but he doesn't like the trade. Yeah, I can't say it's the same as the CeeDee Deuce trade. You know. I mean, the Saints got, what, a seventh-round pick and a fifth-round pick and, you know, swaps for exchange for a – I mean, it was bad. It was awful. But you get a first-round pick. Basically nothing, he says. He's fired up. Let's head back to the phone lines. Good morning. Welcome into the Great Scott Show. Hello.
That's a moment when I wish Norm was still on the show and he was pressing that somebody's been smoking and drinking, but that he used to always press. Because I don't know if everybody remembers, but three of arguably the best receivers in football, Jerry Rice, Terrell Owens, and Randy Moss, played for random teams at the end of their career. I definitely don't think their legacy was tarnished. Also, Tom Brady finished in the top three passing yards and took his team to the playoffs. Was he normal Tom Brady? No. But, I mean, I don't know how many NFL quarterbacks.
He wasn't great this year. The Bucs were bad. He didn't tarnish his legacy.
Yeah, no, not at all. And about the trade, and this is the part that blows my mind, Scott. This is just my personal opinion about the trade. I don't know what people thought they were going to get for Sean when Sean probably had all these stipulations and had all of these requirements for who he was going to coach and where he was going to coach. The Saints got a first-round pick. They got a second-round pick for a third. They got something. They could have gotten, like, the Oklahoma City Thunder and got nothing whenever Kevin Durant left.
I just wish – I don't, look, you got two picks in the top 64. That's not bad. I just hate that they had to throw in that third rounder. That one. That's like the only thing. Yeah. That's the only thing. It's like, no, you don't need to do that. Just
Oh, no, I get it. It sucks. But let me ask you this. If the trade would have broke and you'd have saw Saints trade Sean Payton for first pick this year, and that was it, would you feel the same way?
I mean, no. I mean, they got slightly better, but
I think it's because of giving something else. Of course it is.
And the Saints, look, brother, the third round has been very, very kind to the Saints. You know what I mean? Very kind. They've done well in it.
But so has the second round, and so has the end of the first round. In fact, I remember distinctly
the end of the first round. I mean, Peyton Turner.
I remember sitting at
Patrick Robinson.
I remember sitting at Schilling with you at the one and only ESPN 1420 draft party.
Ryan Ramczyk was great. Ryan Ramczyk was a great pick. They also lucked into it because they were going to take, what, Reuben Foster?
Yeah, I'm not saying they weren't. I'm just saying that there's potential. And the Saints are the Saints. The Saints are going to probably Saints it up.
Having a first-round pick is great. If you hit on a late first-round pick, it can be the most valuable pick in the NFL. It can be.
Yeah,
you've got a player at controlled cost for 5 years. If you hit on that, it's huge. If you don't, if you do a Peyton Turner or something like that, then, you know, way to go. So a lot of this just comes down to what do they do with these picks, and time will tell.
Yeah, and one more thing before I hang up and listen. You know, a lot of fans who saw the Chris Olave trade didn't really care for it. Now they see the Eagles with the 10th pick. They're like, man, that hurts. If the Saints would have gotten that pick where they thought they were going to get it because of how good they thought they were going to do, it would have been a late first-round pick. which is exactly what you just got for Sean.
Yeah, but that's a mighty big if. The reality is they weren't good, and it's a top 10 pick.
I agree. It's a big if. But my point is that's what everyone who was hyped up about the season expected. So we got exactly what we expected, a late first round pick. So I guess my thing is I'm not as depressed. And also with Tom Brady retiring.
I'm not depressed at all, for the record.
Absolutely. Yeah, I know you're not. I'm talking about the average person on TikTok and Twitter and everything. But I feel like the division is just as wide open as it's ever been. And I'm not saying that the Saints have had the best past couple seasons in, like, how they've been running the team and decisions they made. But it cannot be worse than the rest of the division. The rest of the division is a joke. So I think they have every opportunity to capitalize on that.
Be careful.
Anyway, man, have a good day. I'll hang
Thanks.
Up.
Appreciate it. Be careful. Dennis Allen might be somewhere saying, hold my beer. All right, we got time for one more quick phone call before we bring Gerry Glasco on here in a couple minutes. Good morning. Welcome into the Great Scott Show.
Hey, Scott.
Hey, what's up?
I just wanted to say the greatest defensive end in Saints history was selected 24 in the first round, Cam Jordan. So.
Cam Jordan, who's going to another Pro Bowl, by the way. I it's a flag football game now, but he and Andres Peter going, and apparently Tyler Huntley, who threw two touchdowns. But sorry, I'm getting off track. No, Cam Jordan was great. Cam Jordan was a great pick, and they've had some good picks late. You know, they got a hit on this one. They got to.
Do you think he's the greatest defensive end in Saints history?
Defensive end, probably so. You know, Wayne Martin was really, really good.
Oh, really good.
But I think Cam's longevity, I think the stats, I think all of it, I think Wayne Martin was underrated. I think Cam Jordan is properly rated, you know. Sometimes he gets a little grief. I mean, he has some seasons here or there that are off. But, yeah, just straight defensive end-wise, yes, I think he is.
Mickey Loomis always does that. With every trade, I feel like he gives in too much. You know what I'm saying?
Like, well, he just throws in the extra.
Even with the CD do stuff.
The extra. What are you doing swapping 6th and 7th? Just, what are you doing?
And, like, he even did that with Max Unger and Jimmy Graham, too. He gave him, like, another pick. I don't know. And that's the only thing that irks me, man. Like, I feel like you want to be a 4th, a 5th, something like that, you know? I don't know.
Third me, pick's like, good, man. Throwing in a top 100 pick is yeah, there's some value there. You know, it's the only thing that was annoying. But other than that, you know, when I saw they got a 1st and a 2nd, I was like, okay, yeah, yeah.
Dude, yeah. So do you think that, like, what are the biggest needs on the team? I think defensive line and running back.
I think yes. I think
and possession wide receiver.
I think they've got a lot, but I think you nailed two of them. Obviously, quarterback, throw that in there as well.
But, like, I don't think that's, like, a thing that they can draft. I think they have to go veteran.
If you're talking specifically about the draft, that's different. You just asked what their biggest needs were.
Okay.
The Saints have always been best player available. I just, you know, if the best player available is a linebacker, you know, you might not need to take them, but they will. So we could harp all day about the position they should take. I think they're going to take whoever is best available on the board.
It's funny, if you follow Cam Jordan on Twitter, as soon as the trade happened, he's like,
D-tackle.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
D-tackle, quarterback. And then they called him out. He's like, yeah, I said what I said, and I know a thing or two because I play here. Like, all right, Cam.
Right, exactly. He knows what they need, and they need a defensive tackle.
Big time.
So I think that's, you know, hopefully they're leaning that way. Anyways. I appreciate it, Scott.
Thanks, man. Have a good one, David. We'll take a quick timeout. When we come back, we'll shift gears. We'll circle back. We'll circle back to Sean Payton and some of the other news and notes from the world of sports. A little bit on the awful January for the Pelicans. But we'll talk a little Raging Cajun softball next. The season is 9 days away. And when I'm telling you guys right now, I am of the belief This might be the deepest team they've ever had. Ever. In program history. We'll talk about that and more with head coach Gerry Glasco back in 2 minutes on The Great Scott Show. 103.3 The GOAT, simulcast on 1420. It's The GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all.
103.3 The GOAT.
Yeah, that's the one.
K277DQ Lafayette, 1420 KPEL Lafayette. Pardon us, well, we butt in with a little common sense. 103.3 The GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all time.
Great Scott!
The Great Scott Show.
And as they head into the final furlong, all of the other radio stations and radio hosts are left in the wake of a keen turn of speed by The Great Scott Show, the champion.
With Scott Prather.
Steal the show.
Hello, everybody, and welcome into the Great Scott Show. 8 o'clock hour. We are in the month of February. Welcome. That also is the month for first pitch on the diamond, baseball diamond, softball diamond. Raging Cajun softball. Their season begins in 9 days at the 37th annual Louisiana Classics. Softball right around the corner. And joining me now, as he has many times in the past, is the head coach of the top 25 ranked Louisiana Raging Cajun softball team, Gerry Glasco. Good morning, coach. How are you today?
Good morning. Just fighting through these last few days to get to the opening day. Kind of an exciting time, but also a stressful time.
Let's start there. What is the biggest stress when you get to, you know, the last week, or in this case, 8 or 9 days, just that last stretch before the season has that official first pitch? What's the biggest challenge? What's the biggest stress?
Well, you want to work like everybody's working as hard as they can work, trying to get everything as close as we can get it to being ready for opening day. And then you have to limit all of that by health and making sure, you know, your pitchers don't overthrow, your hitters don't overswing and hurt their back or get an elbow, get tendonitis in their elbows or wrist. Your infielders throwing, you know, they're just overuse is a battle. And so just staying within the realms of what you can physically do at a time when mentally you're pushing really hard to get more and more and more and more done to meet those last second expectations.
Is this the deepest team that you've had since you've been here, coach?
If we stay healthy, we're really deep. And that's where we're constantly, you know, where we've been deep the last couple of years. We've had a lot of injuries that we were able to actually, you know, minimize. And you know, we lost Rayne O'Neal 2 years in a row for the whole season, arguably the best player on the team and one of the best players in the country when she was healthy and able to play. And we lost her and were able to come through it. We lost Taylor Romans for a season. Just over and over, you know, we lose Julie Rawls with concussion, and we lost Langlears last year for a week with concussion. We've had multiple, like 8 or 10 major injuries the last 2 years, and we were able to overcome that because we had depth. And arguably, this is probably the most deep team that we've had if we stay healthy, especially. So that's a good thing. You know, we're at a point in our program where, you know, we could possibly redshirt some really talented young players if they ask to be, if they want to go that route and they want to save that year of eligibility for their fifth year, we're in a position we can allow them to do that. Now, those decisions are some of the things that we'll be making here in these next 10 to 15 days, maybe even not even till a week after season starts. But, you know, it is a deep team, and
That can change, though, in a second with an outfield collision, a break out of the flu. There's just things that can you learn as a coach. Like, you can feel really deep and really, you can feel like your roster's loaded, and just in a few hours or a few, a matter of days, you can be depleted and be hanging on for dear life. So, yeah, it could be, and it maybe end up being, and we got a lot of work to do. The other part of being that deep roster, if our freshmen continue to develop, the freshman class is really excited me and made me proud. But at the same time, like, they're not where I want them to be. They're not where I need them to be. There's a lot of development that has to go on between now and May to make them, really count in that quality of roster that we want to have.
Coach Gerry Glasco, our guest. You mentioned some freshmen. I'd love to ask you about a couple. Maya Davis, true freshman. Some feel like she may be your center fielder. I guess time will tell. Victoria Valdez, she's a true freshman. She can play a lot of places. Kylie Griffin. I mean, could you speak to some of these newcomers, Coach, and how big of a role you anticipate them having?
Well, there's seven in that freshman class. You've got two pitchers in it. Chloe Riosetta is a left-hander, and she'll definitely, unless she asks the red shirt, she'll definitely be a factor in our rotation. We're coming down these last 10 days, and I don't think Coach Justin knows yet where he would exactly see her in that rotation. So as we get to the right end of the preseason, we'll explain where we see her, where he sees her, and then we'll give her, the feeling of what he's thinking exactly. And then we'll decide if it's going to be, if she's going to get enough innings that we know we need her this year, then there's nothing to talk about. If we're concerned that, maybe we're not getting enough innings, it would be worth passing out year on, and that's a possibility. Kyler Pitcher would be almost the exact same scenario. And then you've got five position players. Vic Valdez is a catcher, third baseman. Right now, she's our second leading hitter in the spring practices. So she's had a really good spring, offensive spring. I don't think there's any question she's going to be in the starting lineup a lot of days. How often is yet still, to be determined by these last 10 days of preparation. But definitely going to see a lot of playing time. And she's a very, very good defensive catcher. She's also a very good defensive player at third base. And really anywhere we put her on the infield, she's been able to play very well.
Yeah, I'm sure.
So
it's
really nice addition.
Yeah.
Yeah, Vic, a very nice addition to a ball club. She feels the game. Like, her player IQ is just phenomenal, especially on the defensive side of the ball. So that's really been a positive of the spring practices. Maya Davis is an outfielder. And, it's kind of Maddie Hayden and her are so similar. They're both very fast. They're both very hard-nosed players. They don't strike out much. They put the ball in play, and then they can both really play defense. Now, we've been using Maddie a lot on the infield at third base, and we're going to keep her where we can move her in and out of that infield throughout the season is what our plan is. So that's kind of why we've put Maya more in center field on a regular basis, because we know that Maddie's going to be helping us at third base at times when we need her there. And it also allows us to make some room in that outfield that's really talented, especially in that sophomore class where you've got a really good Caleb Alterman. Sam Grader is now back. And it's just a really good outfield group. We've also had Taylor Roman out there quite a bit. We've also had Jordan Campbell out there quite a bit. So, and Carly Heath. So moving Maddie's the one. She's played shortstop in high school. She's just really good on the infield, and she's a little bit more versatile where she can come in and out. And that's kind of the reason that we've got Maya in center. So then you go from there. You got Sissy Vasquez, middle infielder, really good on the defensive side, getting better daily offensively, I feel like. And it's just a matter of how fast we can catch our offense up to our defensive, because our defensive game is superb, and we need that. And she'll definitely, you know, be a defensive player for us in any game that she doesn't start. I would expect to see her, especially in late innings. But I think she's going to start a lot of games for us this year.
You mentioned defense. Coach Gerry Glasco, our guest, Louisiana Raging Cajun softball coach. You guys had spurts of inconsistency last season on defense. How much has defense been a focus last fall, in January, and leading up to this season opener 9 days away?
Well, it's been a huge focus. I mean, we've really put an emphasis on it. We understand that, you know, in the areas that we of the game, you've got defense, offense, pitching, and it felt like there's room that we can grow on that defensive side and, you know, increase the number of runners that we threw out this year, turn more double plays, make less errors, but not just that, just get to balls. There was times, you know, there were plays we didn't make an error on, but we just didn't cover the infield like we want to cover the infield. And then outfield, I thought was probably our strength last year. I thought we had a pretty good infield, outfield, but they were young. And so we know we can get better. And we're just, you know, we're working hard to get better in every phase of the game, pitching, offense, defense. But we've taken away, I think, and moved a lot of the offensive time over to the defensive side this year. And it's starting to show. Like, I feel really confident that we've made some really good improvement on the defensive side.
Coach Gerry Glasco, our guest, your pitchers, I want to, you know, get your thoughts a little bit more on that. I will tell you, months back, one of my daughters was on a field trip out there. She's young, and, you know, she went and was watching Coach Robichaux and Coach Prejean work with Kendra Lamb and Sam Landry, and then they, you know, they let her watch. They signed a little ball for her, made her feel really special. And she'd been to a game with a grandpa before. But let's just say, you know, she's got her eye on the pitchers. So even though she's young, she wants me to ask you about the pitchers for sure. But that was very nice of Coach Robichaux and Coach Prejean. And they definitely made her feel special. And your team has always done a great job. I know you had fan day last week, but just of reaching out to the fans, and you know, I just wanted to say that before I ask you about this staff. You mentioned a couple of freshmen who can throw, but you've got familiar names, Coach. I mean, Kendra Lamb, Sam Landry, Megan Schwarman. We know Carly Heath can throw. You know, there have been times where you'll say, you know, I feel like maybe we have one, at times two. Do you feel like you've got, you know, four veteran pitchers that you can put out there anytime? What's the plan as far as usage rate for these pitchers going into the season? I know it's subject to change, but ideally, what would in a perfect world, how would you utilize this staff this year?
Yeah, I think that, you know, we've definitely got four veteran pitchers that are really talented, and there is no doubt the freshmen also are very talented. And then the one, the surprise of spring, like Vic Valdez has been kind of the surprise of spring on the offensive-defensive side. I think the surprise of spring that the most pleasing to me as a coach is Tyler. Tyler Uvas really had a great spring. So that's the fifth name in there on the veteran group. Like, she's a redshirt freshman, but she was here all year last year, and she's pitching at a high level. Coach Justin and her have made some tremendous progress. And you know, she had a great day on fan day, and she had a great outing the outing before that. So I feel like there's five pitchers right there besides the freshman that can really give us quality innings. And I'm anxious, like, you know, I'm anxious to see what Tyler Uve does when we get a chance to put her in there against a top 25 team, because she reminds me a lot of Chelsea Wilkinson, who we had at Georgia. Her best pitch is very similar to the pitch that Chelsea threw that made her so successful. And so I feel like all those kids are in the middle and, in the middle of Justin's thoughts and as he's trying to formulate a way to use them most effectively. And that'll continue to probably change based on their health, you know, who's got a sore arm, who doesn't. But he's definitely got veteran pitching this year and pitching experience to come back with. And then he's got, a more complete understanding of what he has in his bullpen and how to use them this year and year two. And then I think all those pitchers are really benefiting because of the comfort level and the trust relationship they've developed working together with Coach Justin over this last year and a half. And so that's all going to be a positive factor as we go into the season. And my understanding from Coach is that he's looking to, have a 2 or 3 starter rotation. There'll be times when he wants to use 3 starters, and there'll be times when he wants to use 2 starters. And then he'll figure out who complements the starting pitcher best in the relief row. So he may pair up, a up pitcher with a down pitcher in relief, or he may put a hard-throwing starter and then follow her with the most deceptive pitcher that can throw some off-speed. He'll work on who complements who and how he wants to make that rotation, and I'll leave that up to him.
Coach Gerry Glasco, our guest, with a team like, with the depth you currently have, do you foresee having somewhat, when I say set lineup, I don't mean like all 9 every time, but somewhat of a set lineup where, okay, you'll rotate a couple of pieces and there'll be a couple that are always there? Or do you anticipate altering the lineup a good bit just based on the opponent?
You're talking about pitching or defense?
I'm talking about defense, yeah.
Yeah. I don't know yet. The competitions were 10 days away, and it's so intense and so close that I'm not sure whether I'm going to have a – I know I won't have a 9-player rotation. I'm going to have a 11, maybe even 12, maybe 13-player rotation based on what I see here down the last 10 days.
Okay.
So I think you'll see between 11 players that get really significant innings and significant playing time. And I would think that there will be, a group of 3 or 4 that I feel like come season on February 9th, I got to have these 4 in the lineup to win any given day. But I feel like I can rotate these other 7 in these last 5 spots or maybe even 8 in these last 5 spots. And that allows us to always have players ready and have depth. And it keeps some really good, important, hardworking players involved and helping us win games and keeping our program. So I like, if you look at what we did last year, I was able to play a lot of players. I think every freshman had 60 or more at-bats, something like that. So if you take 3 at-bats per game, you get 60 at-bats, that's equivalent of 20 games. I really like that. Last year was a building year where I was trying to build depth and experience for the future. This is a year right now I'm going to go into it not trying to do anything based on the future. It's all about this year. And so that could also change things. We get off to a great start. We go down to Florida and we have success. That could affect when we come back from Florida. We're in a position to host a regional, a super regional in the second week of the season. It might cause me to coach completely different than if we go to Florida. We take our lumps in Florida. We realize that, we got the possibility to be really good in May, but we aren't good the second weekend of season like we hoped we would be. So that might lend more to playing a bigger rotation and keep looking for a better way to put the puzzle together. So everything will be based on how the season flows. I don't have a preconceived idea.
Yeah.
I do know I have 12 or 13 really nice ball players that I would have loved to have had when I got here in 2018, and I'm just absolutely thrilled to have them now.
Coach Gerry Glasco, our guest. Let's wrap up with something you just touched on, and you mentioned Florida, right? Talking about the schedule, you guys open up in 9 days at home. You take on Lafayette College and Stephen F. Austin each twice, but then you go to the Clearwater Invitational. I mean, this schedule is no joke. You guys are scheduled to play four teams in the top 10. Then you go and take on Central Florida and Orlando shortly thereafter. They're ranked 15th. Of the seven games you play on that Florida road swing, five of those are ranked in the top 10. Then you also have Michigan, who's ranked in some polls, and then throw Indiana in there. You come home, you face off against LSU twice. You know, the weekend after that, you got Texas twice. You got Ole Miss on there. During spring break, I think you guys are at A&M and Baylor. I just, off the top of my head, Coach, I might have missed one or two in there. I think when you got Florida in there, I mean, this schedule, when you guys put this together, I know being at UL, you're often thinking about RPI and regionals and super regionals and how to be able to host and how that schedule can dictate that. What went into this schedule and it being as, honestly, I know that this program has had some pretty stacked non-conference schedules in the past. I don't know that I've ever seen one quite this. I mean, this thing is loaded, Coach. There's no other way to put it.
Yeah, I went back and I looked at the schedules from like 2000 on, and it looked like that the formula at that time was to play 9 to 10 Power 5 teams, and 6 to 8 of those Power 5 teams would be top 25 type teams. And I looked at that, but it's a new generation, you know, and it's not the RPI formula and the way things are working now. And I looked at really closely at what Central Florida did last year. You know, Central Florida was a 16 seed, I think, maybe 15 seed. But they got into the seeding for the regional. And the way they did that was they played about 15 games against top 40 teams. And they didn't even win. I think they only won less than 50% of them. But they had some big wins, you know, important wins. It showed they could play ball. And that's what I tried to do. I tried to look at what they did. I think we have the talent on our roster to do that. And I think that it gives our kids a chance. I don't know that we have to win 10 of those. There's 19, I think, games against Power 5, two being Rutgers. But there's basically probably 15 games, 14 games of teams inside the top 50. Mm-hmm. You know, when you count in Baylor, Texas A&M, Michigan, Indiana will probably be number 60. And that at the end of the year, I would expect Indiana to be in that 60-70 range at the lowest. They could be as high as 40 or 50. So if we can win, you know, between 33% of those games and 50% of those games, I think you're in a position to host the regional, especially if two or three of those wins are against top 10 teams. You know, that's the key. Like, we have to pick up some wins against top 10 when we play that many. I've given us a lot of opportunity. You don't have to win every game against top 10. You don't have to go 500 against top 10 to be a top 16 team. And then the key behind all that is when you get done, you have to dominate the conference. And so I think I look at it this way. It's a no-lose situation. We go in. We're going to play as hard as we can. If we aren't capable of winning those games in February, it's going to make us better for the conference. We dominate the conference. And then we come back out, and we use the things that we learned in the early season to make a better run at the end of the season on the road in the regional or super regional. That's not putting us in any different position than we've been in the last two or three years. But on the other hand, if we can go out and we can win, if we can go 8-10 in those 18 brutal games, you're going to probably be in position to host a regional as long as you pick up a win over some of the top 10 teams. The other side of that is, what if you get red hot and you go down to Florida and you pick yourself up 4 or 5 wins, or you go to Texas and you get a win over Texas, or you go to Florida and you get a win over Florida, and then you know, you play well against Ole Miss here at home and LSU, then all of a sudden you possibly could be in a position to actually host not only a regional but a super regional. So the schedule is just what I felt like the girls deserved. They deserve the opportunity, what we can do with it, what we can make out of it. That's what we're going to find out. But it's exciting to a coach. And then it gives the fans the knowledge that, you know, we did what we could do. We went out, we played everybody we could play. And, you know, we'll know what kind of ball club we got going into the Sun Belt Conference season. And we'll just continue to get better every day in practice, or try to get better every day in practice from that point on. And it won't be long now. We're gonna be in the middle of it. We'll know where we're at.
Tell you what, man, it will. It can go by fast. But to your point, you mentioned it earlier, a lot of how you guys begin the season and how you do in Florida and in non-conference can dictate your approach to the rest of the season. And you don't want to box yourself into a particular lineup, particular way to play. You kind of let it play out. So on one hand, Coach, you have that balancing act of, look, we're taking it day to day. We want to win all our games while also looking at the bigger picture and your ultimate goal this season. And I know y'all's goal is to get to Oklahoma City and play in a Women's College World Series. And it's one of the things that, you know, you've worked on, right? Kind of that balance. But you've also, you know, I want to commend you. You've always been great about communicating that to the fan base and being very open about why you guys do things a certain way and explaining it in a way that I think makes it easy to understand. So I appreciate you taking the time. Anything else, any words you want to share with the fan base before we let you go this morning?
The schedule, too, is not just about this year. I think it's important that fans understand that. Like, getting A&M back on the schedule was huge, you know. Well, so we're going to A&M, and they'll come here. Baylor last year was not in a position to play us. 2 years ago, they came to us, so it was my turn to go to them. But they'll be back here. So this is a year when you look at the schedule, if you're a season ticket holder, you say, man, wish we had a few more home games. Florida had come here. We went there. Now we're going back to Florida again. You know, I have the guarantee. I have Timmy Walton's word that he'll do everything he can to come in here and play on his way to LSU or some way, somehow. But, you know, it's not something he can put on paper that he'll come. But we're going to a lot of these places, and you can expect to see us get return trips from them in the next few years. Texas was here for a doubleheader last year, so we'll go to a tournament in Austin. And we probably won't get them here for a tournament next year, but we can probably get them back for a doubleheader on their spring break, something like that. We've got a really good relationship there. So some of this is about building relationships for the future to keep our program, you know, on a national level, known as a program that's competing with the best. So in the short term for this year, where we don't have as many home games against top teams as we have on the road, just be patient, because that's the plan, obviously. And like Ole Miss is coming to us this year. We'll definitely have to go to Ole Miss next year and get with them. But that's another thing that this schedule is about, not just this year. It's about setting this up for the future to where we can continue to have an SEC-type schedule while playing in the Sun Belt. So just so fans understand that, it's not just this year. Because I have had a few fans say, well, man, we want these games at home. Well, I do, too. I would much rather play Florida, Texas, Texas A&M, and Baylor all here. But the way the schedule worked out, we either had to play them on the road or we just didn't play them, and we definitely benefited to play them.
There's one more I meant to ask you about, Coach. I mean, James Madison coming into the Sun Belt. I know you guys go there this year, but the impact of having a team on the schedule in conference, a huge road series. I mean, they've been in an NCAA regional every year since 2013, with the exception of the COVID year. You know, they've been to several super regionals. They were in the Women's College World Series. You know, I'm looking at, you know, from 2013 to 2021 anyway. Having James Madison on there in the conference now, what does it do for, you know, the conference as a whole, and how does it benefit specifically Raging Cajun softball?
Yeah, it's great to have another nationally respected mid-major in your conference, you know. And you take the last few years, you know, Central Florida and James Madison and Louisiana,
Those are your three top mid-majors. So he's got two out of three in our conference, which is huge. If you look over the last 20 years, Fresno State was that type of program, but they're not quite there right now. And James Madison had a little bump in the road there after the World Series. I think that's to be normal. But you can, they've got a great coach, and they've got such great history. There's no doubt they're going to be right back up at the national level and stay in that top 50. And you've got Texas State that's also, like, really peaking right now. So the pitching in the Sun Belt Conference last year was the best it had ever been. And I think that with James Madison bringing in a really talented freshman pitcher, and you've got Marshall that's having success. This is really, our Sun Belt Conference has really grown and improved.
Coach, I appreciate you taking the time as always. All the best this season. Always enjoy our conversations and look forward to seeing Raging Cajun softball once again this year.
All right. Thank you.
All the best. That is okay. Gerry Glasco. Go Cajuns, he said there at the end. I appreciate him coming on the show. You can email me, scott@1033thegoat.com. You can tweet the show @1033thegoat. If you're tuning in late, we have covered Sean Payton, trade to the Denver Broncos, Tom Brady announcing his retirement, and more. January, oof, get rid of that for the Pelicans. Kind of break down the state of the team right now, where I'm at with everything. All that coming your way, plus open phone lines and emails. This is 103.3 The GOAT, simulcast on 1420. It's The GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all time.
Pardon us. Well, we butt in with a little common sense. 103.3 The GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all time.
Hang on, no, please. Move me.
Welcome back into the Great Scott Show. Phone lines open 337-269-1077. Lindsay emails, says, Scott, I hear you mentioning James Madison to Coach Glasco and said that they had been in the tournament every year since 2013. What about last season? You know what? That's a fair point. Last season they weren't in the tournament, though they might have been. Many feel like they would have won their conference tournament had they played in it. Now, by their standards, it wasn't a good season, but they canceled the rest of their season. I think it was in early May. They unfortunately had a death on the softball team. Lauren Burnett was a star catcher for them and died, was classified as a suicide, and they canceled the rest of the season. That was the decision they made, but that's why I didn't really bring up last year, because technically they didn't play in it, but talk to the Fabulous Cajun Chicken in the 7 o'clock hour. Chris Lano said, the last time he returned, he made out with my girlfriend, now wife, in the stands. It was great stuff. Made out. Let's make sure we put that in quotes. Heck kind of mascot is this? I found that interesting. My first question to him was like, so many of the skits and bits you did back in the day, they probably wouldn't fly today. He's like, you're right. Or I asked him, do you think, you know, you'd be able to do all that today? He said, no, just a different culture, but he'll be there this Saturday night. Looking forward to that. Derek emails. Scott, I'm having a hard time understanding why so many Saints fans are very upset about the return for Sean Payton. I mean, he wasn't going to be there anyway, and the Saints got a first-round pick for him. I know people are upset about the pick swap, but at the end of the day, Payton was never going to be the coach of the Saints, and I doubt they would have gotten anything better next year. The Saints wanted a first. They got a first. They were never going to get what Tampa gave up 20-plus years ago for John Gruden. Maybe I'm looking at it through black and gold glasses, or maybe the other fans are, but I feel like it's a good haul. Haul is a term that would insinuate it was a ton. I think it's fine. I hate that they throw in the third rounder. You get a first and second for Peyton. Yeah, okay. I just don't like that they threw that in there. I don't like that they threw it in there. Jacob emails. Scott, do you believe Tom Brady? I do. Now, I believe him today. Will Brady get in the booth like Jason Witten did and be like, I don't know, man, I kind of want to play. Oh, that team just had it. Probably not. I don't know. I might end up being wrong on this one, but I believe Brady. I do. 103.3 The GOAT. Good morning. Welcome into the show.
Hey.
Hey.
All right. Before I get to my other topic, Coach Glasco, it sounds like he's got his team going to play everybody in the top 25. Is there anybody in the top 25 he's not playing?
There are some teams, but let me tell you something, bro. They'll have their opening weekend next weekend here. They'll be 4-0. But when they go down to Florida for the week, I mean, they're going to play seven games. Five of those teams are going to be ranked in the top 10, and a sixth team is going to be ranked in the top 25. Another team is going to be ranked in the top 15. The only team not ranked, I think, that they're playing is Indiana. Then they come home. They face off against LSU twice. Then the weekend after that, they play Texas twice. Then after that, they play Florida twice. I mean, that is as loaded a schedule, non-conference-wise, as I've ever seen in the history of UL softball.
Yeah, it sounds like it ought to be pretty exciting high level softball.
Yep.
I mean, yeah, and it sounds like he has a plan to, you know, I mean, very good chance. I mean, if they go through that gauntlet in pretty decent shape, it sounds like they got a chance to host a super regional, which he's got a plan. If it doesn't work out, it ain't gonna be because he didn't make the right plan. Mm-hmm. Anyway. Back to, you know, you had a caller that called after me and then said that you ought to be using the smoking and drinking button. And then he goes on with it. He puts the sunshine pumping rainbow shooting, skittle shooting machine on full blast in total overdrive right after he talks about me smoking and drinking. Bottom line is it was a terrible trade. Because if you would have stopped with Denver's number one, which it isn't Denver's number one, it's San Francisco's number one. It's the 29th pick in the draft, which isn't much. And then you get the number two pick. If you stop right there, I'm okay with that. But why did you have to give the number three pick back? Mickey is terrible. I'm telling you, he's horrible, and I'm tired of him trying to convince me that he had to trade up to get this guy or that guy, because if he didn't, oh, surely they were going the next pick. How many times have we heard this, and then this player, whoever it is that he trades up for, ends up being mediocre to, you know, just not what it was supposed to be? And now we've done heard this story. I'm going to tell you, this is a similar story. Oh, well, we couldn't have got any more for Sean Payton. Bull crap, okay? You look at the history of coaches that have been traded in this league. None of them that I recall had ever won a Super Bowl before. And you look at the trades that they had gotten. Bill Belichick was still bad Bill Belichick when New England gave the Jets a number one for him. Okay? It wasn't the great Bill Belichick. It was Bill Belichick like Dennis Allen Bill Belichick at that point. He hadn't proven anything in his career. And then you have the same situation when you had John Gruden go from the Raiders to Tampa Bay. The Raiders got two number ones and $8 million for a guy who had never won a Super Bowl at that time, as I recall. maybe you can refresh my memory and explain to me how come the Saints couldn't get for a 15-year head coach who had turned, who had a massive winning record with a football team that had had a history of losing and had turned that organization around, how you couldn't get two number ones or at least a number one and a number two for him without giving up a number three?
The Gruden package was never going to happen, though. I mean, it wasn't.
Say again?
The Gruden package was never going to happen. Teams value picks more than they did 20 years ago, 22 years ago. I'll agree with you on one thing and disagree with you on the other. I won't say that the 29th overall pick is not much. I don't agree with that. I do agree with you that you shouldn't have had to give up a third rounder, and that that bothers me. That bothers me a lot, for the record. So I'm halfway with you on that, Kyle.
Well, it's a typical Mickey Loomis, I'm going to throw something in because I'm desperate. He's always tipping his hand. I need to make this happen. So I need to make this happen so bad that I'm willing to give you something that I shouldn't have to give you just so I can make it happen to try to make myself look good. No, man, I'd love to play poker with Mickey Loomis. I would take everything he's got. Every single time we sat down at the table, that dude be walking home in his drawer, in his croissants, every single week.
His gazons.
If I played poker with him weekly.
His gazons.
Later.
He'd be walking home in his gazons. Me put on my gazon, my granny, they got like that. Didn't know we'd be getting into some Cajun French here on the show. I can't say that 29th overall is not much. It's a first-round pick. It's a first-round pick. Oh, it's not top 10. No, it's not top 10. It's a first-round pick. And the Saints didn't have one. And now they do. Now, they could strike out on that. I'm telling you, when you hit on a late first-round pick, it's the most valuable contract in the NFL. The Ravens trading back up into the first and getting Lamar Jackson and having him at control cost for as long as they did as an MVP player, and they had were able to lock him into a fifth year. I know that, you know, they've got a standoff now and they need to figure out what they need to do. Ryan Ramczyk, that was one of the best contracts on the Saints books for a while until he got paid. And yeah, you could say, oh, well, you know, what about the third round pick? What about those are all great when you hit on those two. Those are awesome. And I hate that the Saints gave up a third rounder, and they've done well in the third round, but you only have controlled costs on those picks for 4 years. Now, if you strike out and this 29th overall pick bombs, or they give it up to move up or do something out of the idea of trading back is something the Saints have never done. But the idea of trading back out of the first round when it's a late first round pick is a big no-no. You don't want to do that. Now, you got a cat like Peyton Turner who hadn't done squats, so you might not want him for that fifth year where you could lock him into the fifth year of the rookie option. There's no telling the Saints aren't going to screw up this pick, but I can't look at the 29th overall pick and say, it doesn't matter. Jacob emails. He says, Scott, why are you saying 29th overall? I thought it was the 30th. No, it's 29th. The reason being is the Miami Dolphins had to forfeit their first-round pick for all the ownership stuff and tampering and all that other stuff they did. Yeah. So, technically, there's only 31 picks in the first round this year. Appreciate the email. Scott at 1033thegoat.com. The New Orleans Pelicans. I will admit, I was wrong. I did not see this January coming. Even when Zion Williamson pulled his hammy, for a while, I said, look, they got to stay afloat. They got to win the games they're favored in. And if they do that, they'll be okay. Yeah, they'll take some L's, but they'll be okay in the standings. And for a little while, they did, right? For a little while, they did. You know, you'd lose to the Nets. You'd lose to the Mets. Oh, but you beat the Wizards. You'd lose to the Celtics. Oh, well, you beat the Pistons. And I figured, okay, you win some games at home. on the schedule that are coming up later in January, like the Wizards again or the Timberwolves, and you win road games against teams like the Magic. Well, that's not what's happened. And you got Ingram back, but he's only been back two games, and he's looked a bit rusty, to say the least. But you're missing Zion so much right now. Did I think that the Pelicans were going to lose nine games in a row? Of course not. Was I wrong about their ability to stay afloat and maybe stay in the top six of the Western Conference in January? Of course I was. Not by much, but that doesn't matter. When I say not by much, point is, they win a couple of those games like the Wizards, like Minnesota, and like Orlando, which I thought they would. Heck, they'd still be in third place in the West. But they lost those, and they've lost nine in a row, and they're 3-13 in the month of January, and it's horrendous. And they go from Milwaukee to Denver and then to Dallas. That's a pretty rough stretch there, guys. And you got the Lakers Saturday and the Kings, who were third in the West, on Sunday. But you're also only two games out of fourth place. But you're also one game out of not even being in the top 10. You've got depth, but when your two best players are out, I overestimated how good that depth was. I was wrong. I thought they could at least, over that nine-game stretch, win three of those games. I don't feel like I was looking at it saying, oh, they're going to still be in first place and they're going to be great. No, you knew when Zion got hurt and they were still missing Ingram that it was going to be a rough stretch, but I thought they'd be able to win games like Minnesota. But their problem has not been defense, as much as people want to make it out to be. It has been their offense. Bad offense has led to tons of easy transition points for the opponent, and it has killed this team. Prior to Zion and Ingram both being out in the month of January, this team had one game all season where they failed to reach 100 points. They lost that game, by the way. Over this stretch, they did it three times. They also had other games where they just barely eclipsed 100. The offense has horrible quarters with no ball movement where nobody can figure out how to score. Outside of Jonas and McCollum, who McCollum had some off nights, they could not get consistent scoring from anywhere. The three-point shot, which was falling earlier in the season when Zion was in the lineup, is clanking more times than not. They had a good first half last night, but they were in Denver. You figured the altitude, you figured the two-time MVP would catch up with them, and it did. This team desperately needs a win right now. That seven-game win streak when Zion windmill dunked the Suns into the sun and the Pels were sitting in first place and everything was smelling fresh and the idea that Ingram was going to come back at some point soon, boy, that feels like a long time ago, doesn't it? If, and it is a big if this team can get healthy and stay healthy, they will be okay. They will be at least in the top six of the Western Conference and not in the play-in. If they keep dealing with injuries, if Zion comes back and then leaves again for a stretch, if Ingram can't stay on the floor, this team's going to be fighting for the play-in again. Now, when they got in the play-in last year, they happened to be playing their best basketball. And they were playing a lot of catch-up late in the year. Do they need to make a trade in the next 9 days? Yes, they do. They need to add some outside shooting. They need to add a ball handler on offense that can distribute the ball to free up McCollum a little bit more, especially when Ingram's not on the floor. They need to make a few moves. But more than anything, they need to get healthy. And the reality is, the superstars in New Orleans have not been consistently healthy since, oh, I don't know, ever. I take that back. Chris Paul is pretty healthy most of his career. He was. David West, too. Though he tore his ACL, but at that point, he never played for the team again. The best, the most healthy season the team has had in franchise history was the 07-08 season. What do you know? It also happened to be the best record in franchise history. But to just assume that this team is suddenly going to get healthy and just it's going to be great is a huge assumption. Assumption of the risk. What tells you historically that these guys are going to be able to remain healthy? Jonas is going to be healthy. CJ's probably going to be healthy. But your two best players, they miss a lot of games. When Zion plays, he is one of the best players on the planet. There is no question about it. And when he returns, the Pelicans will start winning lots of games again. If you believe he is going to return and stay healthy, then you believe the Pelicans are going to be a really, really fun team to watch in April and into May. If you believe he's going to get hurt again, get ready for a play-in. It's as simple as that. Yes, I still think they have a very deep team, but I overestimated the depth a little bit. Admittedly. They desperately need a win right now. That's going to do it for the Great Scott Show. Dan Patrick's show coming up next. Big thanks to Russell Heim, the Fabulous Cajun Chicken. Big thanks to Gerry Glasco. Big thanks to all of you for listening. Have a great Wednesday, everybody. I'll talk to you tomorrow morning, bright and early, on the Great Scott Show. This is 103.3 The GOAT, simulcast on 1420 The GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all time.